Hi, and welcome to Lecture 2, which is titled Structured Cabling Topologies. Here, we'll present the generic structured cabling system designs for buildings and campuses as recommended in standards publications. But before we get there, let's answer the question, what is structured cabling and why do I need it in my building? Structured cabling proposes the installation of a universal cabling system that is independent of the users, devices, and types of networks that will occupy the building, both now and in the future. In order to appreciate the enormous benefits of this approach, you have to go back in time to a period when every computer system had a unique type of cabling. If you wanted to buy a different system, you had to rewire your space, which could span an entire building. In larger buildings, the cost of the rewiring would be higher than the cost of the new computer system, not to mention the disruptions and inconveniences of opening up the ceilings, walls, and floors to run the new cables. So along comes structured cabling in the late 1980s, with the proposal to make the cabling system for telephones and computers a utility, like water and electricity, a standard resource that would be independent of such things as who the users were, what types of phones and computers they wanted to connect, and what types of networks they wanted to use. Now, if you wanted to buy a new telephone or computer system, everything would plug into the existing telecommunications outlets, so you only had to worry about the price of the new system. No new cabling needed, just like with electrical outlets and the devices that plug into them. This was especially appealing to multi-tenant commercial building owners, who couldn't know ahead of time what future tenants would require and would love to avoid installing and reinstalling different types of cables on various floors as tenants came and went. That's it for the history lesson. Let's now jump to the present with a look at the current generic cabling topology for customer premises. Here's the generic cabling model as defined in TIA and global cabling standards. What we have here is a hierarchical star topology, consisting of connection points linked together with cables. The rectangular boxes labeled DC, DB, and DA are physical spaces within buildings, such as enclosed rooms. These contain distributors, a term originally introduced in international standards publications to describe cabling connection facilities. If you have a campus, distributor C would be the top-level connection facility in the main campus building, and it would have links to each distributor B serving another building on the same campus. If you're not dealing with a campus, but instead, for example, a 100-story office tower, you'd have the same setup, but the distributor Bs would be spread out vertically in your tower. For example, 20 floors apart, with distributor C in the middle of the building on the 50th floor. Distributor As are the floor-level connection facilities, located in one or more distributor rooms on each floor of a building. A cabling link from distributor A can go directly to an equipment outlet or EO, such as a wall-mounted faceplate in an office. Optionally, it can go to a zone-based consolidation point, or CP, along with multiple other cables, and from there to an EO. The consolidation point serves as an additional connector between distributor A and, for example, equipment outlets within open office modular furniture. Whenever the open office furniture needs to be moved or reconfigured, only the cables from the affected EOs to the nearby CP need to be replaced. The longer cable runs from the CP to distributor A can remain undisturbed. The third possibility is a direct link from a building distributor or DB to an EO, without the need for another distributor, as highlighted here. This would be appropriate, for example, in a relatively small single-floor building, where the DB can serve all equipment outlets in the building without exceeding cabling length limits. Let's now look at the generic cabling model as applied to a single building environment. In this side view of a four-floor building, backbone cabling links distributor B in the building's distributor room to individual distributor A's in distributor rooms on each floor. And the second link in the chain is horizontal cabling, linking distributor A on each floor to each of the equipment outlets on the same floor. Note that historically, equipment outlets were associated with individual work areas, such as enclosed offices and open cubicles. In today's intelligent buildings, outlets are likely to be located everywhere to enable connections of network devices such as security cameras, building controls, lighting, and audio-video equipment such as digital signage screens. Here's a variation of horizontal cabling that includes an optional consolidation point for additional flexibility in managing the cabling infrastructure. In this example, if equipment outlets need to be moved around on the second floor, you only need to replace the work area cables up to the consolidation point, not all the way back to the second floor distributor room. And here's another variation that groups multiple outlets into a single large capacity faceplate called a multi-user telecommunications outlet assembly, or MUTOA. For example, everyone in a conference or meeting room can connect their laptops to a single MUTOA in the middle of the shared table instead of trying to reach an outlet on the wall behind them. Next, we'll apply the generic cabling model to a multi-building or campus environment. In this top-down view of a four-building campus, the distributor room in the main building on the left contains distributor C, or the campus distributor. Outdoor backbone cabling connects this campus distributor to individual building distributors, or distributor B's, in each of the three satellite buildings. Note that because this is a top-down view, the distributor rooms containing distributor A's on each floor of every building cannot be shown. With this design, there are no more than two distributors, B and A, between distributor C in the main building and any equipment outlet on any floor anywhere on campus. And once you specify the maximum allowable cabling lengths, network equipment vendors know with certainty how far their signals need to travel anywhere their products are installed. If you're on the other side as the buyer of network equipment, you know that as long as your cabling infrastructure is standards compliant, you can buy any vendor's equipment and it will work at your location. That's the benefit of standardization. Next, we'll take a closer look at the horizontal cabling topology specified in standards for serving a single floor. As shown here, a maximum of four connection points are allowed between the device plugged in at the work area on the left and the equipment serving that device from the distributor room or DR on the same floor on the right. The maximum allowable cable length from distributor A in the DR to the equipment outlet or MUTOA at the work area is 90 meters or 295 feet. This segment of the horizontal cabling is called the permanent link because it's usually left undisturbed as devices or connectors are added and removed at work areas and the DR. An additional 10 meters or 33 feet is allocated for all cordage used at both ends, bringing the total end-to-end or device port to device port length to an even 100 meters or 328 feet. The addition of cords at both ends transforms the permanent link into the channel. If a consolidation point or CP connector is used, recall that it's optional. The standards recommend a minimum 15 meter or 49 foot distance from the DR in order to avoid having multiple connection points too close to each other, which can negatively affect signal transmission. As well, any individual CP should serve no more than 12 user work areas. And if a MUTOA is used in place of an equipment outlet, it should also serve no more than the equivalent of 12 work areas. Next, we'll illustrate the four possible connector combinations for end-to-end horizontal cabling, starting with the basic two-connector topology. Here's the basic channel setup, with two connection points, one at each end. Note the use of the term interconnect in the DR on the right, which indicates a single connecting point for both the horizontal cable and the connection to the network equipment. In this case, an equipment cord plugged into a patch panel port at one end and a switch port at the other end. We can transform the basic two-connector topology into a more flexible three-connector topology in one of two ways. Here's the first way. We add a consolidation point in the form of connector 2. As described earlier, this design enables the partial replacement of the horizontal cable if connector 1 needs to be moved at any time, without disturbing the entire run. And here is option 2. We add a second connection point in the DR that is dedicated to the network equipment. This transforms a single patch panel interconnect into a two-patch panel cross-connect, also adding a third cord between the two patch panels. The main advantage of this setup is the isolation of the switch. Once all its ports are connected to connector 3, the unit does not need to be touched in order to reassign its ports. Everything can be done at the cross-connect, and the switch can even be hidden from sight or locked up in an enclosure if there are security concerns. The fourth and final combination is the four-connector topology. As illustrated here, the four-connector topology consists of both a consolidation point connector near the work areas and a cross-connect in the distributor room to maximize service and administrative flexibility. This brings us to the end of Lecture 2, titled Structured Cabling Topologies. Thank you for watching.